Hey gang, I'm David Ulevitch and I lead the security practice at Cisco. And before that, I was the founder and CEO of OpenDNS. I want to thank Mark for the great talk, and in the spirit of true vendor collaboration, I'm going to give you a nearly identical talk right now. Just kidding. Mostly. I also know that I'm the only thing standing between you and lunch, so I'm going to keep this tight. And I want to start the discussion today talking about breaches, because I think of a breach, no matter how big or small, as a tax on the global GDP, right? The gross domestic product, the total combined economic output of everything that we do. And so in that way, that breach tax, all the work that we do to reduce it, is a worthwhile and honorable effort. And I think many of you feel this way. You know that security is more than just a job. That's what we do to improve the state of our art. It's why we do it. And what we do protects and defends the people we work with, the communities we're a part of, and that's really important. In some ways, you could say that we are the protectors and the enablers of the global economy. It might be a little bit grandiose, but I think it's pretty true. So that means a lot to me, and it really is a privilege for me to be up here in front of you all today, so thank you. And I want to talk about how it feels to me when I look at the attacker ecosystem, the vendor ecosystem, and maybe this is how it feels for you. It's not a very pretty picture. In fact, it's the same picture that I learned 20 years ago at my first job. I worked at a mom-and-pop internet provider in San Diego, and my boss, this guy John Mendenhall, taught me this very simple equation for how to think about the good guys versus the bad guys. He said that over here, the bad guys, they have unlimited resources, unlimited time, and they can just keep trying and trying and trying over and over again, and they only need one attack to succeed for all their efforts to be considered a success. On the other hand, the good guys, we have limited resources, we have limited time, and we actually have to know all the ways in order to protect our infrastructure. It's not a very fair equation. It's highly distorted and imbalanced. And I actually think the deck remains stacked against us today as much as it was 20 years ago at my first job. And let me just give you two quick examples. So this first example happened right here in our own backyard last November. The San Francisco Municipal Transit Agency, our MTA, they were hit with a random commodity ransomware attack. And those of you that were here this morning heard all about ransomware. But this was not some sophisticated nation-state attacker going after our critical infrastructure. This was an attacker with a script. They just had unlimited tries and could scan the internet, and they happened to find something very serious, right? Usually we think of ransomware as infecting a desktop, it encrypts the files, maybe we pay the ransom, we don't pay the ransom, it's highly inconvenient, it's very expensive. But this was an attacker who was just praying and spraying with a script and was able to disable a critical part of our infrastructure. So not only was it embarrassing, but it was highly inconvenient. They shut down the machines that issue fares and the ticketing systems that accept, you know, the turnstiles that accept your tickets. The second example is this sort of mega DDoS trend that we've seen. And there are other talks here at RSA that dive into this. And while DDoS itself is not necessarily a security vulnerability, it's often the result of vulnerable devices that have been compromised and then combined together into an attack. But this past October, we saw the Mirai botnet was used to attack Dyn. It was one of the largest DDoS attacks in history, but it was not done by compromised desktops and servers that we know well how to protect. It was done by a tremendous number of IoT devices that were directly connected to the internet and that were vulnerable to compromise, and then they were used to form this botnet and do this attack. So all the attackers had to do was keep running these automated scans and these scripts to compromise as many vulnerable IoT devices as they needed until they assembled a large enough botnet, and then they were able to launch an attack that very few organizations on this planet can withstand. And there's no consequence for the attackers trying over and over again. They just have that unlimited time and those unlimited resources. And if you think that it's bad today, it's going to get worse in the future. Today, we have 10 billion devices connected to the internet. Just consider that by the year 2020, they're predicting that we will move to 50 billion devices. Right? That's like a million devices an hour that are being connected to the internet. To put that in perspective, and 2020 is not like in the future when we're going to have flying cars. It's like 3 years away. It's just around the corner. Like whenever people are like, oh, it's 2020, that's so far away. That's 3 years from now. We're going to have 50 billion devices. And that's not the only thing that's changing, right? Data center bandwidth is increasing. That makes it harder for us to inspect traffic east-west with inside our networks, inside our data centers. More and more traffic is becoming encrypted, which is generally a very good thing, but from a security standpoint, makes it harder to inspect. Imagine if all malware just used SSL and HTTPS to send out to commands back to their command and control. So if we're not great at protecting things today, when we have 10 billion devices, then we're really going to be screwed when we get to 50 billion devices. And that unfair equation will just get more and more distorted. But I think we can change the equation, and we can actually tip the tables in our favor. Right? I'm an optimist, and I actually think that we have tools in our toolbox that we can better leverage, that we're just not using them to their full potential today. But before I jump into that, I want to share with you a little bit of a philosophy that I have for how I think about security and how I think about my product vision that drives everything I do at Cisco. But I think it's also a useful tool for all of you to think about your own security posture and how you evaluate security solutions. So I think of security not as a point in time, right? Like, I don't want to answer the question for the CEOs and boardrooms that I get put in front of, and I wear a suit when I'm in those meetings. I don't want to answer the question of, like, are we secure? Like, that's not the question that I'm answering. I want to think of security as a continuous motion. Because even if I said yes to the question of are we secure, that's just right now. Well, what about right now? That was then. This is now, right? Maybe if we were just secure then, we're not secure now. Security is a continuous motion. So I want to think about security as this, really this question of, is our security posture effective? That's the question I want to start answering. And when I think about that philosophy and how we answer it, to me, it's very simple. There's some blocking and tackling we have to do, right? You want to block everything that's bad. That's obvious. You want to do whatever you can to segment the network and user access and put as much user access control in place as you can. But beyond that, to me, an effective security posture is really the pursuit of shortening our time to detection and then tightly coupling that with a shortened time to response. And that's critically important. The tight coupling of a shortened time to detection with a short time to response, to me, that's the holy grail of security. That's how you have an effective security posture. If you don't block something that's bad, well, then you want to find it quickly and you want to do something about it quickly. So why aren't we doing that? It's because we lack automation. And I know I'm not the first person to say, oh, we should automate security. Like, it's not rocket science. But there are reasons why we haven't automated security. So I want to talk quickly about why we haven't automated security, because I think it's illustrative for us to understand why we're in the state of affairs that we're in today, and then talk about some of those tools that I think we can better leverage to actually drive towards automated security. I believe that the only way we're going to have an effective security posture is by moving towards automated security. So let me talk about the two problems with automation today. The first is what I think of as the silo problem. We're in an industry that's marked by point solutions and niche vendors. You can walk around Moscone and see it for yourselves. In this environment, it encourages our customers to adopt myriad solutions that are all independent and don't interoperate. In fact, we've surveyed thousands of CISOs, and we do it in a double-blind way, so they don't know that it's Cisco asking, and we don't know who's responding. We just know that they're either CISOs or security practitioners. And companies may have up to 50 different security vendors in their environment. And that's OK, except that they're all bolted together, but they're not communicating, and they're not interoperating. And as somebody who used to be a security practitioner, it's bananas, right? We've allowed this whole IT security landscape to evolve into this incredibly complex and siloed industry. And that's what makes automation really difficult. So vendors can talk about APIs. Like, when I meet with startups and I walk around the halls, people are like, oh, we have an API. But that's a cop-out. All APIs do is shift the burden of integration to customers. APIs just represent potential. What we hear and what we need in the market to drive towards automated security is integrations. They need to work out of the box. So we're going to have to change that if we really want to help close that security effectiveness gap. So that's issue number one, the silo problem. Issue number two, maybe it'll come up there. Oh, good. The ominous robot is up there. So the second problem, as you can see, is that I'm worried about what happens when we turn on automation and we let the machines take over. So this is not about AI problems, like artificial intelligence. That's not the problem that I'm worried about. I'm actually worried about the opposite problem, which is the AS problem, the artificial stupidity problem. Right? I'm not worried about creating Skynet from Terminator and having the machines rise up and kill us. I'm actually concerned that the automation that we enable will be so stupid that I'm going to get a phone call on like at 2:15 in the afternoon on a Thursday because the CEO was just getting ready to present to the board and the network kicked her off the network because it saw that her iPad was left at home and was checking email automatically, and our automated security thought, hey, wait a minute, she can't be in the office if her iPad's at home, and so it quarantined her and segmented her off the network. That's not artificial intelligence. That's artificial stupidity. The AS problem is not about the robots taking over and making bad decisions. Oh, sorry, about taking them over. It's about them making bad decisions because they lack context. Right? That's the issue. They're missing enough signal to make smart decisions. We're worried about false positives, and that's what gets in the way of automation. We're worried that we're going to impede people's ability to do their jobs. So the two problems, the first is that we can't actually automate anything because they don't talk to each other. The second problem is that we won't automate anything because we're afraid of false positives and breaking things. But I believe that we have a secret weapon in our toolbox that will help us unlock some of these problems and let us actually drive towards automation. This is like a dramatic pause. OK, so what is that secret weapon? Dun, dun, dun. The cloud. And in my rehearsals yesterday, people were like, oh no, this is going to be a talk about the cloud. This is not last year's RSA. Don't worry, I promise. This is not about network security as a service, how you're just going to backhaul all your traffic to one vendor in the cloud, and they're going to magically decide what's good and bad and solve all your security problems. This is about making the cloud a tool in our security toolbox to help you automate your security and achieve an effective security posture. So let me show you what I mean by that. So the cloud offers some capabilities that we don't usually have today in our normal security stack. It gives us unlimited hardware, on demand whenever we want it. It gives us unlimited storage. That means we can store things for long periods of time. And you can't do that with a single hardware appliance on-prem. And when you have both of those capabilities, you unlock unlimited analytics. And analytics are what allow us to use the compendium of all the security knowledge that we're storing, all that information, to very quickly come to a decision point. I'm talking about detecting a threat, analyzing the origins, seeing where else we've seen it, looking at user behaviors and historical baselines today and every other day in the past, and then coming to an instant threat analysis. To me, the cloud is this incredible security state machine that we can be capitalizing on, but we're not today. Remember our CEO who got kicked off the network? Well, when you have the cloud as this incredible state machine, it can be smart enough to know that she only brings her iPad to the office sometimes. That's not a strong enough signal to quarantine her off the network. Maybe we do something like step-up authentication, or we make her re-authenticate to the network. Another example, we know that the cloud can know about every executable that's ever been run. You can send a hash up and tell me who's run it, how many times it's been run, whether it's benign or malicious. You have all this context around every file. You don't need every part of your endpoint infrastructure to know all that context. You don't need to like download hundreds of megabytes or gigabytes or terabytes of data to everything that ever wants to analyze a file. The cloud can know that and can respond quickly and in real time. So that's half of our holy grail. But what we learned with G.I. Joe was that like knowing's only half the battle. What we need to be able to do is do something with knowing, right, when you have that knowledge. So the cloud is purpose-built for integrations. If the cloud has all the data and the context that we need to be able to make smart decisions, then the second thing to do is to leverage it as a nexus for tying it all together. To go back to that example of file hashes, right now, most software out there sends up a file hash, whether it's endpoint software or network security, and says, tell me what you know. But when it sends up a new file and we decide that it's bad, we don't want to just tell that one endpoint software. We want to tell everything. We want our email security to know. We want the web security to know. We want every part of our security stack to know all at once. I hate when I see great threat intelligence that's only then used in a siloed way. We need to disintermediate that and integrate across everything. So everything has to work together in the cloud. That's like the default state, right? It's like a rule of the internet, is things work together in the cloud. Like DocuSign works with Salesforce without any programming. It's just a checkbox integration. But security needs to work the same way. So I believe that the cloud is going to become a nexus of orchestration and security policy, even if we still have lots of endpoint software and hardware appliances. We just need to take all the knowledge we're storing, come to a decision point, and then push it out quickly. And so one of the epiphanies that ends up happening when you start to think about the cloud in this way is it becomes an ideal management plane and a control plane. It's where you have all the knowledge and where you get to push it all out. And that's an important shift in the way that security people tend to think about cloud. Most people think of cloud as like just a new IT surface that we need to protect. Like, oh, I have people using Azure or AWS. I need to go set up firewalls or security policies. But this is about really using the cloud as a tool in our toolbox in order to drive towards automated security. That's what allows us to better balance the tables against our adversaries. Leveraging the cloud in this way is how we're going to enable automated security, because we're going to be able to tie everything together. And so to me, that's how we change the equation. That's how we're going to be able to better balance those scales. And remember that when they have their unlimited attempts and their unlimited number of tries to attack us, well, now we have something unlimited too. We have unlimited compute and storage and analytic capabilities, and through integrations, we can tie it all together. Right? That's something powerful that gives us a huge advantage over the current state of affairs. So they can run their infinite number of attacks, but then we get to track and analyze and contextualize and automatically respond to every single one. And we can do it all in real time. And it becomes very hard. This is one of the things that we start to discover as you start to build these kinds of solutions. It becomes very hard for the good guys, or sorry, for the bad guys to look like good guys. When you have all this historical security state up in the cloud and you know the traffic patterns of good users, you know what anomalous traffic looks like, and you're keeping state on the internet at scale, it's very hard to look like a good guy when you're a bad guy. And this kind of capability has never actually existed before, but I believe we can build it as an industry, and as customers, you can demand that we get there. And so if you're a customer out there walking the halls, you need to hold us to the fire. And you can hold me to the fire, I'm gonna hold my team to the fire, but collectively, you need to push all the vendors to get there. And if you're a vendor, I hope at the end of RSA that you're a little bit annoyed with me because all these people are coming to your booth and asking questions about integrations and cloud. And as you're walking around RSA today, I'm gonna give you a couple questions that you can start to think about. And it's not just as you're walking around, it's even as you think about your own security stack back in the office or environment that you work in. You should start asking these two questions, because by asking these questions, and as we as a collective group get to the answers on these questions, we will be able to drive towards automation. So the first question is, how is this gonna leverage the cloud to unlock unlimited analytics, right? How am I gonna use it as a tool in my toolbox to process incredible amounts of information in real time? And then obviously the second piece is the integration piece. What turnkey integrations are built into this product? Does it tie in with the rest of my security infrastructure, into the rest of the investments I've already made into other security products? Is it gonna work together holistically? Is it gonna make my security more effective and more integrated? Answering these questions is what holds the key for us to be able to take the 10 billion devices we have online today and move them securely to an environment where we can connect 50 billion devices. And we're not gonna stop at 50 billion. I've seen predictions that think we're gonna get to 500 billion devices, right? So it's gonna be an environment where we have to drive orchestration and we have to drive automation. So that's how we're gonna turn the tables, that's how we're gonna balance the equation, and it only works if we leverage the cloud as a tool in our toolbox. And I don't see a lot of that happening, and so that's the discussion we wanted to start today. So we all have a lot of work to do, but I always believe that the things that are really worth doing are supposed to be hard. Like, that's what makes it satisfying. It's not supposed to be easy. But I know that that is what's gonna be able to enable us to advance our industry, and I know that all of you take the work that we do and that you do all very seriously. As I said at the beginning, to me it is a privilege to be here. We have an opportunity to reduce that breach tax on the GDP. I don't think that that's a crazy way to think of what we do in security, right? We are enablers of people to conduct business and connect with confidence. So the work that we do matters to so many people, and it means so much to so many people. So I appreciate your time. I appreciate you for everything you do in security. Clearly, you can tell I'm passionate about this work. So thank you for the time. I enjoyed being up here on stage with you at RSA. I hope to be up here next year with you at RSA and tell you how far we've come. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference, and now maybe enjoy some lunch. Thanks.